Thank you, everyone, for being here. And it's my pleasure to welcome Mario. And yeah, it's all yours. I'll give you a 5 or 15 minute.
Okay. I'm going to talk about the Lean 3 Math Clinical Library, also known as MathLib. Lean is an open source interactive theorem prover developed primarily by Leo DeMora at Microsoft Research. It focuses on software verification and also formalized mathematics. Mostly, I'm going to be focusing on formalized mathematics. It's based on dependent type theory. Importantly, we're not going to worry about hot here. The foundational system includes. You can not use the axiom of choice, but most things do. So we don't really make an attempt to be intuitionistic. Unlike Cook, so this is one of the major departures from, even though the foundational systems are rather similar, we take a different approach at the beginning. So for the most part, the theorems are all classical. Lean 3 also includes a metaprogramming infrastructure for Lean, which is written in Lean so that people can write programs to do proofs in Lean. A short history of Lean and MathLib. Lean has gone through several major versions. Currently, we're all using Lean 3. Lean 4 is in development by Leo and Sebastian Ulrich. The Lean 2 math library was developed by Jeremy Avogad and Floris van Doorn and some others. I think Rob also should be mentioned on this list.
No, thanks.
We should have
I should have read more source files to source that. The Lean 2 math library was sort of the origin of the MathLib library, but Lean 3 was not backwards compatible with Lean 2, and so for various reasons we sort of just decided to start over so that we could make use of some of the new features and such. MathLib is what came out of that. MathLib is the latest version of the Lean 3 math library, and it is primarily being developed by myself and Johannes Hosel. Stein likes to show pictures of merge commits, you can see over the past roughly 1 year, myself and Johannes have been working on this quite a bit. I'd like to talk a little bit about what is it that is actually in here. MathLib has sort of two main goals, and I'll call these sort of the computer science and the math goal. The computer science goal is to build a standard library for Lean as a programming language. So this is going to be something sort of like what you would expect from your standard C header files or whatever, so that you have a standard library, or like the standard library of Python. You know, these sorts of, you want to have lots of basic data types and all the operations you expect on these data types. But in particular, Lean has the ability to do proofs and programs in the same language, and so this positions it very well as a tool for doing verified programming, and so we also want to have proven correct data structures and algorithms. This is one of the major goals of the MathLib project, is to be able to support the development of these things, and also just to have libraries of verified programming data types and such. And then also to have tactics and decision procedures using programming framework, we can use the tools which we build inside our tactics, and that helps for the second goal, which is to build a library of formalized mathematics, and also to set things up so that other people can also use the library to write their own formalized mathematics. So these are very complementary goals. You can use the computers, you can use the programming infrastructure in order to build better tactics. You can use the tactics to prove theorems, and you can use the theorems inside the construction of these verified algorithms. So they all sort of feed into each other. So one point of confusion I think people often have is what's the difference between Mathlib and the core library? So Lean3 is in a repository. There's a lean repository, and inside that repository there's a bunch of lean code. And that code includes primarily tactics. So it sets up a pretty decent tactic language, and also a small amount of mathematics which is needed to support that. Sort of the development of the lean repository is being headed by Leonardo De Mora, and he has his Microsoft users to appease and such. So there's a difference in focus, I guess, between the people working in Redmond and myself working in Carnegie Mellon and the Pittsburgh area. We're working on this Mathlib project, so that's sort of why there's this distinction. So Mathlib is built on top of the core library, and it is fully compatible. And also the core lean library is actually frozen until Lean 4 comes out, so there's a major difference in activity between these two areas. So what is in Mathlib? So I don't think you can actually see this very well, but this is just showing the top level structure of the Mathlib, and you can see here this thing's in algebra, analysis, categories, computability data, and so I'm going to look a little bit more in detail on what all is going on here. So the data types, this is the data folder which I'm talking about. So this contains stuff like the classical number type. So I'm talking about the natural numbers, the integers, the rational numbers, the reals, and the complexes. The meaning behind data types here is that these are sort of things that you can compute with. So these are data, and you can use them in programming context. So like list here, you can use this in a math context as like a finite sequence of things in alpha. You could also use it as a linked list, because it is a linked list. So there are operations on these which have both mathematical meaning, and also they could be usable as programs if you want to. So multisets is taking lists and then quotienting them up to permutation. If you take out the duplicates, you get finsets. Array and vector are very similar to each other, but they have a different implementation. So array is implemented as an array. Vector is actually just a subtype of list. So these two are isomorphic, and we prove that they're isomorphic in the library. So this is an example of how you can make use of, like, these are two different representations, and this isomorphism here, this is constructive, so that means that this is a function which converts an array into a list, and a list back into an array. So it's all sort of, it all feeds on itself. Just a few more examples of data types. We have equivalences, so these are the isomorphisms. If we were working in a different theory, that might be an equal sign, but it's not. Embeddings are just injective functions. Encodable, so this is a type class here, which says that we have a map from our type to the natural numbers with partial inverse. You can think of this as a Gödel number, and so by having using type classes to build larger and larger encodable things, you can just say that some complicated type is encodable, and then it can apply these type class instances to just figure out how to Gödel code anything. So that makes it very convenient. There's a number of co-inductive lists, so these are infinite lists. This is a list which may or may not be infinite, and this is a list where you may or may not actually have any elements in it. Like, you can ask this thing for an element, and it may or may not ever return the first element. These here are binary natural numbers. Well, this is positive, this is natural numbers, and this is integers. The reason for having a different representation than the so there's also the original this map here. This has an implementation as binary natural numbers inside the VM, inside the when we're executing code. It actually uses binary natural numbers. When you're using the kernel, it uses the implementation which is actually stated for this thing, which if you look at the definition of it, it's the P&O natural number, so it's zeros and successors, and that's going to have horrible performance if you want to do anything on it. So instead, we have this alternative if you happen to be doing kernel computations. Their option is just having nullable types, so if you have a value perhaps, or maybe you don't, and you want to have an explicit null value, option alpha is just sort of the type theory way of doing that. Our option alpha is a very similar, non-computably, it's the same thing as option alpha, but this is sort of, I call it a partial value. This is sort of a value assuming some precondition. And if the precondition is true, then you can get the value. You can use this to implement like a type of all partial function. Moving more to the math things. Here we have so the algebra folder contains a bunch of algebraic type classes. So I'm not going to say too much about this because people should recognize what they are, but just these algebraic structures, and these come with lots of theorems like this one here, just the theorems in the first order theory of semigroups and monoids and such. And we have instances showing that product of groups is a group, or the product of rings is a ring. So this is all found in algebra. Other things, so there's a bunch of order structures, complete lattices of green orders and bounded lattices and whatnot. Set alpha here, this is different from finset, which was mentioned before. Set alpha is just sort of a function to propositions. So this is to be thought of as the collection of all subsets of alpha. And this isn't really data because a prop is not really something that you can compute with. So this is more of a classical notion, these sets. But you can use it when you're doing classical mathematics. So this is useful for that. And it is a complete lattice. That's why I mentioned it here. Filter alpha is also a complete lattice, and this is just the collection of filters. We make a lot of use of filters for topology. So a topological space is essentially what you think it is. It's have an openness predicate, and then it satisfies some properties. We use a neighborhoods filter to define many of the different concepts. So there are many topological constructions like map and induce and co-induce, which you can use together with the complete, this also has a complete lattice structure, which you can do very convenient, like this is much shorter than any other definition I'm aware of for defining what is the product topology as just a supremum of two different induced topologies. This is just saying that this is the coarsest or finest topology, I always forget which is which, which makes these two functions continuous. So that's how it's being defined here. There's a bunch of different topological properties and topological algebraic structures which you can have as well. In the other areas, we also have lots of different theories. This is working at a more high level now. In addition to the topology stuff, we can move up to a uniform space, prove things about uniform spaces, and then do more things about metric spaces. For each of these bullet points, of course, there's 10 definitions, and for each definition, there's 10 theorems, and so each of these represents a significant amount of lines of code of the repository. Measure theory involves measure spaces, measurable functions, outer measures, the Lebesgue measure. I'm trying to mention all the things, more or less the things that we have, so that you can also kind of get a hint at what we don't have. Group theory, we have stuff about group actions and subgroups and quotient groups. We don't have the Fay-Thompson theorem yet. For ring theory, we have a little bit of stuff, but there's actually quite a bit more which is not inside MathLib, so I'm trying to restrict this mostly to what's actually in MathLib. Kevin Buzzard, whose name has appeared a few times already, is working on schemes and defining schemes in perfectoid spaces. In the computability theory, we're working on partial recursive functions, Turing machines, universal Turing machines, the Hulting problem. The number theory is kind of lopsided. We have the Pell equation and Diophantine equations for one particular project that I was working on, and not much other number theory. So I don't think this is quite representative of the field of number theory. In set theory, we do have cardinal and ordinal numbers, so I think we have most of what you would expect of a basic set theory. We also have ordinal notations which you can actually compute with, which is nice. So you can figure out what's the exponential of two things in Cantor normal form. We have inaccessible cardinals. We have a proof that there exist inaccessible cardinals because Lean can do that. We have a model of ZFC because Lean can also do that. So there's also a small tactic library. I mentioned that most of the tactics are in the Lean core library, but where there are some improvements we made, they've been added to MathLib as well. So there's a few additional tactics to do with doing more special kinds of cases, different general purpose automation tactics, and some decision procedures for doing numeric calculations. Or just equalities and rings. It would be nice to add something using Grosvenor basis for doing work with equalities in the context and rings as well, but we don't have that yet. There are also a few other tactics, non-trivial tactics, which are available in the elsewhere in the community. I mentioned here the superposition prover by Gabriel Ebner, and a decision procedure for Presbyterian think there are also a few more decision procedures or general purpose automation tactics written by Scott. Morrison. And there's a more complete listing here. So, okay, so future work. Of course, this is a very open-ended project, so we'd like to have all of mathematics. I have much, much higher, grander plans than, in a more near term, we need a bit more basic analysis. We don't have derivatives and integrals yet. We have a lot of stuff which is working up to it, but we really want to do it right, and so we're building up a lot of infrastructure before we can really get to it. And I already mentioned that number theory is a little bit sparse. Geometry, completely gone, or absent. Trigonometry, we're not too far away from. And many of the basic data structures are missing because I'm sort of waiting for the ability to work with things like memoization, which you need support from the lean compilation process. So once lean 4 comes around, I think that it'll be more possible to write things that are actually efficient and have the sort of stated speeds. So that's it. Thank you.
Any questions?
What does it mean really to have a proof of an isomorphism between vectors and arrays? Is when you say one is in C++, it means you can only set axioms about it.
So the array data type is available in lean. All of these data types are actually available as lean data types.
They're defined.
And, they are defined in lean. They have a model in lean. You can think of the definition in lean as a model. And their implementation, insofar as when you use it inside if you do hash eval and then you type out some expression which uses arrays, those arrays are actually interpreted in the virtual machine which is executing the code as actual arrays. So that's the point at which it uses the fact that it's an array. In lean, it actually looks like a function from fin n, which is like a set of n elements. So on that model, we can prove an isomorphism, and that isomorphism also works as a function which can be executed
in the VM as well. At the very beginning, you mentioned a theorem x plus 0 equals x. But usually it's taken as an axiom, not a theorem. It's just all the axiomatization of anything usual. So is it really a theorem in your case?
I think that's probably a theorem which is a simple restatement of the axiom. There are, of course, more complicated theorems have which aren't just restatements of axioms, like, I don't know, commutativity and associativity combinations. There are many, many theorems which are available in that file and elsewhere, which just sort of build on the axioms. But you don't want to focus too much on what precisely are the axioms of the structure, because you know sometimes some are redundant in terms of others, and maybe there's a slight difference in the way which ones you want to call an axiom and which ones you want to call a theorem. But either way, you want to have all the theorems